بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وانت خير الفاتحين اما بعد my dear respected elders brothers sisters and children السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
وعليكم السلام
I'm not sure if we have sisters here or not but just like in case okay So welcome back to our Sunday after Maghrib talk. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this opportunity to come to the house of Allah, offer our Maghrib Salah in Jama'ah, and sit after completing one obligation, completing our Salah, to listen, to get reminded and motivated. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow me to penetrate right through to your heart and get the message across, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit all of us from whatever will be said, inshallah, in this session. We are invited here for dinner after the talk by one of the sisters from our community who has achieved, mashallah, great success in her education. And she requests all the brothers here and the elders to make special da'ah for her and her family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them and fill their life with happiness and barakah, Allahumma ameen, and take them from one success to next success, inshallah, and make them successful in this life and the life to come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase his barakah in all of our lives, inshallah, protect us and our beloved ones from all types of difficulties and harms, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our children and make them the best help and support to Islam, Allahumma ameen. I know that a lot of parents are expecting a lot of trouble in the next couple of weeks because kids at home, school holiday, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So it's gonna be really, really hard. And you got to be careful, that's my advice to myself. You have to listen carefully, give them a full attention, otherwise you will be in trouble. Our kids are really smart, and sometimes they trick us to, you know, get in trouble. Like this little girl, 7 years old, she was drawing hard as, and she finished his picture, and she came to his dad, to her dad, who was busy on his phone. And she took the opportunity that he doesn't pay much attention, and she said, Daddy, hey, what's that? What's going on? He said, look at the picture that I have drawn. Oh, beautiful, nice. But you haven't seen it. Look carefully. He looked, oh, wow, that's amazing. What is it? Guess. He said, oh, it looks like it's a scary monster. She said, no, this is my mom. He was a nice man, you know, by the way. So be careful and mind your words, because you know. So that's a big responsibility for us to look after our kids and make sure that they receive the best advice through practice. It doesn't make sense that you lie and tell your children, if you lie again, I'm gonna give you a hiding. If you do this, I will do that. I mean, you first have to apply it on yourself before you pass it on to other people. Your kids are very, very smart. They will not let it go if you are kind of, you know, cheating them or we are not, you know, honest with them. We don't have magic sticks to touch our children and they grow up righteous and nice. You have to open, you know, honest conversation. Long conversation with your kids, with your family. You have to talk to them, you see? I mean, don't try to be busy or don't pretend to be busy and you're doing nothing, just like, you know, browsing your Facebook or doing something unimportant and ignoring your children and your family. You have to open good in conversation and talk to them. So you find out what they want and what actually, how can you pass on a message to them? How can you educate them? How can you teach them? And you have to be careful, because sometimes, you know, as I said, sometimes you think you are smart and you can get away with something, but your family are there watching you 24/7. I mean, you know, some husbands, unfortunately, they don't have this conversation with their family. They just come back home, eat, sleep, and that's it. So home for them is just like a motel. They just go and sleep and that's it. You know, I remember this wife who said, you know, I wanted to open a conversation with my husband. So I thought of something, how can I trigger him to get him to open in and talk? Okay, what about if I ask him to tell me a story? The wife said, she said, honey, So, Abdullah, is there anyone Abdullah here? Alhamdulillah. Hey, what? Said, can you tell me the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam? A long story. He said, he was lost, then we found him later. In the end of the story. Yeah, this is the end of the story. He got lost, and then they found him late. End of the story, no more. Your family needs some attention, need your time. And you know, that's a good opportunity for us, the lockdown and the school holiday, to start rebuilding and reconnecting back to our families. Wallahi, subhanAllah, I come across some family who now very regretful because their kids gone away from them. And now they are trying their best to convince their children to give them a phone call, to answer their phone. They try to call them and say, Wallahi, ya Sheikh, I'm trying to call my son, my daughter, but they never pick up the phone. Why? Because they are so busy. Yes, they are so busy because you also were so busy. You didn't give them attention. You lifted them to the phone. You lifted them to the internet. You lifted them to the school. You lifted them to the friends. And when you need them and you try to find them, they're already gone. They are not there in your life anymore. You have to be really very careful and you have to give them now because you will need them tomorrow. If you give them today, they will give you tomorrow. And as I said, our children at this time and age, they are really, really smart and they are very picky. They're not like us, you know, when we were kids last century, I believe that most of us belong to the last century. So we were like kind of, you know, easygoing people. But our kids today are not easy. They are really, really smart. They can't let go of anything. You see? You know? So you have to really be very mindful and to be very careful. There was a man back in the time, before the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a really, really nice man. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with three children, three sons, no daughters. And he was a very wealthy man. So before he died, he wrote his will, wasiyya. And he wrote in his wasiyya one sentence. And he told them before he passed away, look, when I pass away, you distribute the wealth according to my wasiyya. You love me? Yes, dad, we love you so much. You are our dad. He said, yes, this is my wasiyya, this is my will. Don't open it today. If once I die, then you open the wasiyya and you put it to practice. This is how I want my wealth, my legacy to be distributed. He said, fine. But the thing is, he got those three children, three sons, and he named three of them Abdullah. Abdullah, Abdullah, Abdullah. And then when they opened the wasiyya, the will, what does it say? Abdullah, take share from my wealth. Abdullah doesn't take any share from my wealth. Abdullah takes share one from my wealth. End of the wasiyya. Who is Abdullah who should take? And who is Abdullah who doesn't take? Because all of us are Abdullah. He doesn't actually put any clue. Well, what we can do, then they went to the wise people in the village or in the city. What can we do? He said, look, we can't tell you. There is a qadi, a judge, a very nice man, far away from here. You guys have to travel and see him and take the wasiyya with you. And he's going to make a judgment. He's going to tell you what you have to do. Because your dad didn't actually clarify it. He just said, Abdullah takes, Abdullah doesn't take, and Abdullah take from the inheritance. So they went traveling back in time, no transport. They were just walking all the way until they get to the qadi. On their way, they found somebody, you know, catching his breath and running, looking for something, lost. And then he stopped them and he said, guys, have you seen my camel? I lost my camel. They said, no, I haven't seen him. Then one of the boys said, your camel is single-eyed. He lost one eye. He said, yes, yes. He also only got one eye. And the other ones asked him, does he have, he doesn't have a tail, isn't it? He said, yes, yes, his tail is cut off. And then he said, the other one, he said, he is like mane. He got one faulty leg, one disabled leg. They said, the man, yes, yes, true. Exactly. This is exactly my camel. Three of them said, wallahi, we haven't seen him. He got them arrested. He said, I'm not letting you go. I will take you to the qadi. He said, wallahi, actually, we are lost. We are looking for the qadi. Take us there. We are looking for him. He took them to the qadi and he narrated the full story. I met those guys on the road and I asked them about my lost camel. They give me full description, precise description, and in the end they said, we haven't seen him. The Qadi said, okay, no worries. They have to take some rest because they look really tired. Give them some food. He asked his servant. They have a kind of, you know, a guest place. So when he received, the Qadi was a kind of, you know, a leader in his position, a high position person. And he got a guest place where he hosted his guests to take rest, when, especially when people travel from farm distance. He said to his servant, go and serve the food for them. Let them take some rest, but keep an eye on them. I want you to listen carefully to whatever they say and report to me everything that they have said. MashaAllah. So he said, okay, fine. And he said to those guys, go take some rest. And then when you relax, come back to me. I want to talk to you. So they went, they had the meal, and they were resting. And when they were eating, once they finished the food, the older one said, I think the woman who cooked the food was pregnant. And the second one said, and I think the meat we eat is not actually lamb meat, it is the dog meat. And the third one said, I think this Qadi is Ibn Zina. He's a son, he's not the son of his father, he's illegitimate son. And then the servant went back to the Qadi and he told him two things, and he didn't tell the third thing. He said, call those guys right now. I want those guys to come in. He asked them, come here. Where is the owner of the camel? Here I am. Come here. You guys give the precise description of the camel, and you said you haven't seen him. He said, yes, we haven't seen the camel. And then he said, how did you know him? He said, look, I have seen the camel eating from one side of the road, and he was not eating from the other side, which means that he only see one side and he can't see the other side. What does it mean? He only got one eye. Yeah, that makes sense. The other one said, look, the droppings of the camel always move his tail when he is, you know, dropping, passing his, relieving himself. His waist comes out, so he cut it in two pieces and it scattered everywhere. But this camel droppings were just solid in one place, so I knew that he doesn't have a tail. That is why I said he doesn't have a tail. And the third one said, because we see the mark is the footprints of the camels, only three footprints, not the fourth one, which means that he is hanging the fourth leg, he is not putting it on the ground. That is why he must have a disability in one leg. The Qadi said, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And of course you haven't seen him. He said to the guy, go and look for your camel. Those guys haven't seen him. Okay, now listen. You have said something about the food, and you have to tell me why did you say that? He asked the first one. You know, what did you say? He said that the food is cooked by a pregnant woman. And then he sent his servant, go to the kitchen and ask the service, who will cook the food? And then he found out, yes, the woman who cooked the food was pregnant. He said, how did you know that she was pregnant? He said, because the bread was thin from one side and thick from the other side. And the pregnant woman can't push the roller very to the end because she can't lean like that. So the bread... Crazy. Then he said to the other, what did you say about food? He said, this meat is not the lamb meat. This is the dog meat. He said, he went to the chef. What kind of meat you serve? He said, this is lamb meat. He said, if you don't tell the truth, I'm going to kill you right now. He said, oh, no. This is actually a dog meat. You know, because, you know, I slaughter one sheep and, I couldn't actually wait. I eat it all. So I just found the dog and cooked it. He said, how did you know this is the dog meat? He said, look, because the sheep and the cow meat is bones and then meat and then fat. These are three layers. Bone, and then meat, and then fat. But the dog meat is bone, fat, and meat. And that is why I knew this is not the lamb meat, this is the dog meat. It has yours already. Shayateen, subhanallah. And then he said to the other one, what did you say? He said, look, I didn't say anything. He said, you have to tell me. He said, you are Ibn Zina, you are the illegitimate son. And then he went to his mom. He said, tell me the truth. Am I the son of my father? He said, yes, of course. He said, no, you have to tell me the truth. But look, your father was a very wealthy man, and he got a problem. He can't have children, and I don't want his wealth to go to somebody else. So I asked somebody, you know, to sleep with me, and then I have you. That's it. He said, Allahu Akbar. How did those? Right? I get to him, how did you know that? Even my mom didn't tell me. I've been with my mom for 40, 50 years, and she never told me. He said, how did you know that? He said, because if you are a kind of a decent person, the son of your father, you wouldn't go and spy on your guests. But because you are, illegitimate son, that you spy on your guests. He said, okay, no one say that unless he himself is the son of, he's an illegitimate son. You are the Abdullah who doesn't take, but the other two Abdullah take from them. So the children, when you teach the children and make them, you know, learn from you by practice, they grow up reliable, they grow up, honest in their speech, and they become smart, because the believer must be smart. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-mu'minu kayyisun fatin. I assume that most of you can read and speak a little bit of Arabic, right? Kayyisun fatin. You know, there was a misprint sometime, and somebody added an extra dot on the letter fa. It's supposed to be kayyisun fatin, which means smart and, smart and creative. It's not just a smart and creative. So adding one dot, it reads like that. Kis cotton. He is, a bag of cotton. The Sheikh was reading that, and he made a mistake. I said, Al-Mu'min is kis cotton. It can read it that way. So the one, how come, is a bag of cotton? That's an insult. How the Prophet say that? He said, no. What can you see inside the cotton? He said, the cotton bag, he said, cotton. How does it look like? Very white. He said, the believer has white heart from inside, just like the cotton. Really? That's not the case. Al-mu'min kayyisun fatin, yani al-mu'min smart and creative. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want us to go just like, follow the trend and do whatever the people do. We need to be very creative and need to be very smart. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received a complaint from somebody. He said, I got cheated from this guy. Okay, forgive him and let go. And then later on he came and he said, I got cheated again from this guy. He said one thing. What did he say? He said, لا يلدغ المؤمن من جحر مرتين. He said, the believer, the true believer, cannot be bitten from the same snake twice. Like if you know there is in this hole there is a snake, and you put your foot there, or you got bitten from there, you don't put it again and get bitten, right? You have to be smart. I mean, Allah doesn't like you that way. You have to be smart. So he said to the guy, there is no, you don't have any right to complain, because you have allowed yourself to be fooled twice, so it's your own fault. So the believer must be very smart and be very, very careful, especially when, we come to dealing with the people. I don't mean that you have to be like kind of tricky or cheater, or you make up, fabricate stories. No. Smart means that you have to give the people their rights, and you have to do the right thing, even if the people didn't like it. Didn't like it. Because in the end, Allah will question you only alone, and Allah will question them. So you will be questioned in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and they will be also questioned alone. No one will answer on behalf of anyone. Everyone is going to answer on behalf of himself. No one will be asked on behalf of other one. So in this life, we have very, 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 very important, responsibility when it comes to the people. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah can forgive. Allah is ready to forgive. Allah is ready to let go. But with people, it doesn't go this way. There is no guarantee that Allah will let it go, or this person will let it go. Because you never know. Maybe this guy is standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, look, this man has taken something from me, and you have to take him to the account. He has to pay me back. Okay, let go of him. No. I don't let go. I want him to pay me right now. And that's too late. You can't sort it out. Subhanallah. You cannot sort it out. That is why there are two surahs in the Quran, very unique surahs in the Quran. They begin with a word. And this word is only mentioned in the beginning of those two surahs, only in the beginning of those surahs. It is mentioned before. But those two surahs begin with this word. The surahs of the Quran, they begin with probably the same beginning. You see multiple surahs, surahs begin with the same beginning. Alif, Lam, Mim, Alif, Lam, Mim, Alif, Lam, Mim, Ra, Alif, Lam, Mim, Ra, Hamim. But those two surahs begin with this word, which is a very scary word. Those are Surah Al-Mutaffifin and Surah Al-Humaza. Surah Al-Mutaffifin start like that. Waylun lil-mutaffifin. Surah Al-Humaza, Waylun li-kulli humazatin lumaza. And the first one is talking Surah Al-Mutaffifin about the wealth, the money of the people. If you touch, if you take anything from the wealth of the people, from their property, you are in trouble. And Waylun likullu humaza is talking about the owner, the dignity, the reputation of the people. If you touch the owner of somebody, if you speak about anybody with a harmful word, then you are in trouble. You are in trouble. And if only the smart believer who doesn't come close to those two areas. The non-smart believer, the foolish person, is the one who keep playing around those two dangerous areas, and he come on the day of Qiyamah bankrupt, as Rasulullah said. He said to the Sahaba one day, "Atadruna man al-muflis?" Do you know who is the bankrupt? They said, "Yes, of course. The bankrupt is the one who doesn't have money, who doesn't have house, who doesn't have, he doesn't have a job. So he's a bankrupt person." He said, "No, I don't mean that." Jazakallah khair, mashallah, barakallah khair. He said, "No, I don't mean that. But the bankrupt of my ummah is the one who comes on the day of Qiyamah." Listen carefully, because it's really, really very critical and very, very important to know that. He said, the bankrupt is the one who comes on the day of Qiyamah with heavy load of good deeds, mountains of good deeds, because he has done heaps of salah. He has given lots of charity. He has done lots of fasting. He has made a lot of sacrifice, right? But قَدْ شَتَمَ هَذَا وَسَبَّ هَذَا وَسَفَكَ دَمَ هَذَا وَتَكَلَّمَ عَنْ هَذَا. He has been just insulting this guy, hurting this guy, abusing this guy, taking the property of this guy. So on the day of Qiyamah, those guys are going to come on the top and they say, "Ya Allah, we want our, you know, our things back. We want our money back. We want a recompensation. We need a compensation for whatever he has done to us." Okay, do you have money to pay them? Can you, you know, reverse the words that you have said? "No, I can't do anything." He said, "Okay, pay from your good deeds." They will start taking out from his good deeds until he runs out of his good deeds. Then he still owe those people a lot. "Ya Allah, he doesn't have any more good deeds." Okay, take from your bad deeds and load on him. And then when he is overloaded with the bad deeds, he will be eligible to go to the hellfire. They will throw him into the hellfire. What happened to his salah? Gone. What happens to his fasting? What happens to him? Happened to his dhikr? Is all gone. All run out. All bankrupt. Why? Because he did not actually behave himself when it comes to the wealth of the people, when it comes to the reputation and the honor of other people. He doesn't care about that. He goes here and there and he talk about those people who talk about this. He just backbite here, gossip here, take from the people's wealth and property. Subhanallah. It's heaps, a lot of things, subhanallah. They tell a story which is not really, you know, very authentic, but it's just there to tell us what is happening. There was a very wealthy man who used to like make a lot of money out of dirty business. So he, before he passed away, he said to his children, "Look, I give you one option only. If you want my money after me, then one of you has to come with me into my grave on the first night. Stay with me in the grave, and then next day in the morning you can get out. Otherwise, if you don't do that, I will give all my money to the charities. None of you will take 1 cent of mine." And he said, "Oh, that's millions of money, my God, what are we going to do?" He said, "Okay, he needs somebody to go with him, right? No problem. We can hire a guy to go with him. He's not going to know who is there, you know. Just hire somebody, give him some money. He will go with the grave, okay?" I said, "Okay, find a poor person and give him some money and let him go into the grave with my dad. And in the morning, we have fulfilled the wasiyah of my dad." So they put the guy in the grave, and in the morning they open it up and take the guy. The guy, after, you know, spending the whole night with his, subhanallah, with his dad, he went out crying and screaming. And he said to the people, "Here you go, this is your money back. I don't want anything." "Why?" He said, "Your dad, one day, long time ago, was riding a donkey, and the donkey didn't want to go. He wanted to hit the donkey, but he didn't have a stick with him. So he stopped by a tree on the road and he cut a stick from a branch to hit the dog, to hit the donkey. So the angel were questioning him about this stick for the whole entire night and beating him up. What is going to happen to him for the rest of his money? He just grabbed the stick from a tree and he was using it to, you know, push his donkey. And the whole night he was being beaten up and questioned about this stick. What will happen to him for the rest of his money? Take your money back. I'm not going to earn any non-halal. Subhanallah. See? So wallahi, brother, it's really very, very critical and not so easy. And listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. He said, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. I mean, usually we take this lightly and say, oh, this is ayat about the kuffar. We're not kuffar, alhamdulillah. We are believers. We are mu'mineen. It's about Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, the bad guys. But alhamdulillah, we are fine. We are okay. But that's not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ, for each and every single person who can be described as humaza or lumaza. Humaza and lumaza. Humaza for somebody who is in front of your eyes. Lumaza for somebody who is not there in front of your eyes. What is humaza and what is wail? Wail actually is the word to express a great regret. Nothing you cannot recover it anymore. Something has been lost and you cannot recover it anymore. Ya wailana man ba'athana min marqadina hada. Woo to us, what happened to us? How did we come back again to life? Abdullah ibn Abbas said actually the word wail, it is actually a place in Jahannam. It's a place in Jahannam, which could be the worst place in Jahannam. That the rest of the people in Jahannam, the rest of the people of Jahannam consider it the worst place. And if the people of who stay in this wadi or this section of Jahannam, if they are given one single wish, they will just wish to go out of that place, even if they have to go somewhere else in Jahannam. You know, for them, this is the worst place in Jannah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. You see? So, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. What is humaza? As I said, something you do it in front of the people, and lumaza when they are not in front of your eyes. When they are there, when they are around, and when they are not around. Humaza is to make somebody feel bad or feel less than you. You show your arrogance or your superiority or you are being a better than them in your conversation. You see, it is really very serious. You see, when you see somebody, for example, and you say, oh man, you know, I'm not the type of guy who, you know, who this kind, do this kind of things. You know, alhamdulillah, Allah doesn't make you me fool or stupid to these kind of things. And you are pointing to him just to make him feel guilty and feel bad and feel inferior. And the kuffar used to see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ahada alladhi ba'atha Allahu rasula?" Is it the guy Allah chose him to be messenger? And they start making fun of him. Is it the guy? How Allah make this mistake and me, hashallah, and choose this guy? Subhanallah. Al-lumaza is to belittle and to disrespect the effort of other people. Yeah? The effort of other people. If people do something and you disrespect them and you show, you know, this is not a big deal. What that? You know, subhanallah. No, it's not a big deal. You see, then when there was also a fake, you know, some fake people, you know, in the government examining people to become imams, also corrupted imams, you know, in the masjid. So those two guys know nothing about deen, and they were examining a guy. He said, how much you memorize from the Holy Quran? They has their own guy sitting there also to be appointed as imam, to get the job. And he said, oh yeah, I memorized 30 juz of the Quran. 30 juz of the Quran? And they look at their own man. How about you? How much you memorize of the Quran? He said, I memorize 36 juz of the Quran. Said, look at that. There is no 36. You see? So when you make the people look, make things look bad, and whatever the people do is nothing, then this is lumaza. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was really, really hard on those munafiqun around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the time of the donation, when there was a need for donation. Some people came back with something, with a piece of bread. Some other people came back with a bag of flour, you know, a handful of wheat, something. This is all what they have. And then, you know, they يلمزون المتطوعين في الصدقات. They said, oh, what is this? I mean, those guys are kidding. We are preparing an army. We need heaps of money. We need heaps of food. And somebody coming with a handful of dates. What does it gonna? It's not going to help at all. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
those people الذين يلمزون المتطوعين في الصدقات والذين لا يجدون إلا جهدهم يسخرون منهم سخر الله منهم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make fun of them in Yawm Qiyamah. They make fun of them here in this dunya. Allah will make fun of them on the day of Qiyamah. It's not about how much they can do, you can offer. It's how much Allah accepts from you. So making fun of what the people do, or belittling them, or making them look really stupid, or look very bad, this is humaza, lumaza. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named in the Quran. So you really have to be very careful when talking about people in front of them or on their back. Because some people try to be smart and said, look, brother Abdullah, is there Abdullah here? Why I'm always target Abdullah? Anyway, there is Samihni, brother Abdullah. May Allah forgive us and Abdullah as well. And everyone here. Said, no, you know, brother Abdullah, I'm going to tell you the truth. You are such a stupid and dumb person. See, I'm not going to talk on your back. I'm talking in front of you. Pretend to be Islamic, super Islamic. You are insulting him. Yeah, but I don't want to backbite him. But also you don't have to insult him in front of his face and tell him in his face, you are stupid, you are such a dumb person. You have to be nice and because this is also humaza, lumaza, it can be counted like that. You see? So anything that put the people down and you deny the favors of the people, or you disrespect their, make fun of their effort and their, you know, good deeds or their contribution, will put you inside this category. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. It is not only about the kuffar, it is about everyone who can fit in this describe. You see people sitting together, have you seen brother Abdullah? Astaghfirullah al-Azim, may Allah forgive all of us. No, I haven't seen him. Okay, you could have said, I haven't seen him. Why did you make this introduction? Yeah, just to make him look bad. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Tell me, what did he do? Allah, don't bite, we'll backbite. Astaghfirullah. May Allah forgive us. Yeah, of course, but when you say that, you trigger in their mind that he has done something really very bad. And now you have to tell us, you know, may Allah forgive me. Allahumma taj'alha ghaiba. Ya Allah, don't make it ghaiba. It is ghaiba, even if you say, ya Allah, Allah is not going to listen to you. So this is a type of a conversation. This is a type of talk that put the people down and make them look bad, whether they are present or not. And this will be counted as humaza and lumaza. We need to be very careful and always talk good about the people, because in the end, we don't know whom does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept and whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala don't accept. You never know. That's a secret between us and Allah. I'll finish with this hadith, and it's narrated by Imam al-Bukhari. One guy said, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Wallahi la yaghfiru Allahu li fulan. He saw somebody really, really bad. He's doing really all sorts of bad things. Then he said, Wallahi, I swear by Allah, Allah will never forgive this guy. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, sent a message to the Prophet of this time and said, go to this guy and tell him, who are you to speak on behalf of me? Who are you? This guy was such a, you know, super Islamic person, you know, was doing all sorts of ibadah, think highly about himself. He said, وَعِزَّتِي بِجَلَالِي. I take an oath by swear by my own majesty and my highness. I have forgiven him and I cancelled all of your good deeds. You go to Jahannam and he will go to the Jannah. Why? Because no one can force Allah or put him under his own rules. Allah doesn't follow my rules or your rules. Allah has his own rules. That is why we always in very bad need, we beg Allah for his mercy. Ya Allah, forgive me, forgive us. You know, accept us, accept. I mean, don't put yourself in a position as the one in charge of the day of Qiyamah. Now, I will send those people to hell, I will send those people to the Jannah. Who are you to talk like that? You need to think highly about the people and always, you know, try your best to improve yourself, better yourself. And don't judge the people. Call the people. Advise the people. If they listen, listen. If they don't listen, let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of them, not you. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take good care of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success in this life and the life to come. Allahumma ameen. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azab al-nar. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'u al-alim wa tub alayna innaka anta at-tawwabur rahim. Allahumma aghfir lana wa rahamna wa afina wa afu anna wa tub alayna wa samihna ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma jazina bil ihsani ihsana wa bil isaati afwan wa ghufrana. وارزقنا من النعم الصالحة يا رب العالمين. اللهم ارزقنا من الحلال الطيب يا رب العالمين. اللهم ارزقنا رزقا حلالا واسعا وبارك لنا فيه. اللهم ابعدنا عن الحرام وابعدنا عن الوقوع فيه. اللهم